morning. It's great to see some of you for the first time in nearly 8 months. Welcome back to the church building. You might have seen me on YouTube, but I didn't see you, so I really missed you. Hopefully, and Lord willing, we may continue to worship together in our own church building in the future. Yesterday was Reformation Day. Reformation Day, celebrating Martin Luther protesting against the corrupted Roman Catholic Church. He emphasized on following the Word of God and grace of God, not the church tradition, not man-made ideas about God and salvation. Unfortunately, Halloween celebrates on the same day, October 31st. For reasons unclear to me, we are being enticed by a dark festival of American origins. In supermarkets, in reject shops throughout Australia, those Halloween items are selling. Why witches' heads and the devil's masks and the zombie costume? I mean, God clearly condemns such things in the Bible. Anyway, by strange coincidence, on the same weekend as Halloween, we Christians celebrate light. Light that has come through those great men of God in the past. Let's come before God in prayer. Let's pray. Lord God of hosts, the refuge of every sinner, and the strength of all who put their trust in you. We praise you for having made us the partakers of the blessings of your Reformation. Without any merit on our part, you have sent your Holy Spirit into our hearts and brought us to faith in your dear Son, Jesus Christ. You have made known to us the perfect merit of Christ. You have directed our faith to rest on the exceedingly great and precious promises of your gospel. You have revealed the beauty of your grace, which rescued us from a just condemnation and which assured us of a certain salvation in Christ. Grant us your grace, that we may receive your forgiveness with thanksgiving. Use us as your witness in bringing the message of a pardon in Christ to people everywhere. Open our eyes to a better understanding of your word and a deeper appreciation of your grace, that our faith in Christ Jesus may grow and flourish with the fruits of righteous and holy living. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Now, we will worship our God by listening to music and singing from our heart. This song will be very appropriate, especially on this Reformation Day, Reformation Sunday. Amazing grace. My chains are gone. I know you want to sing. Sing from your heart.
Was grace that that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear the hour I first believed. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy rains, unending love, amazing grace. Promise good to me, His word, my hope secures. He will my shield and portion me as long as life endures. My chains are
To the Jews who have believed him, Jesus said, "If you hold to my teachings, you are really my disciples. Then you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free." They answered him, "We are Abraham's descendants and have never been slaves of anyone. How can you say that we shall be set free?" Jesus replied, "Very truly I tell you, everyone who sins is a slave to sin. Now a slave has no permanent place in the family, but a son belongs to it forever." Apologies. Now a slave has no permanent place in the family, but a son belongs to it forever. So if the Son sets you free, you will be free indeed. I know you are Abraham's descendants, yet you are looking for a way to kill me, because you have no room for my word. I am telling you what I have seen in the Father's presence, and you are doing what you have heard from your Father. May the Lord add his blessing to the reading of his holy word. I have a few announcements this morning, and you would probably notice there is no notice sheets. As always, that will be sent electronically to you. A few things I would like to say is, please can I ask that everybody confirm that they have either signed the sheet, pen and paper. For those that enjoy the technology of it and don't want to touch anything, there are codes on both ends of the door and at the hall if you haven't signed in yet. I do ask that all the parents individually sign in, and as everybody knows, that is just for tracing if there is any issue. The parents, for the kids, if you just sign in and mention that you do have kids here, that'd be great. Just a reminder, the sisters' Christmas dinner is on Friday the 27th of November at 7 p.m. So please can you RSVP to Fiona or Jenny before Friday the 20th, because as we know, numbers are important to plan for that. Can I ask that for those that would like to join us for morning tea afterwards, which will be provided in the hall, we do ask you to stick to the rules. We do ask you, it's quite easy to want to enjoy the fellowship together. Please do spread out, please use the hall. We ask that you maintain and keep those distances. A reminder that the tea and the refreshments will be served to you, so we ask that you don't touch anything, and please don't come into the kitchen, so you'll find Jenny, myself, or whoever else is helping, will be having a mask, will have gloves on, and they will serve you. For me, the last one is what we have been doing with the trial services is we are getting feedback, and we are asking that if there is something that you find that you are concerned about from a COVID safe perspective, that you please feel free to either email me, Moses, or anybody on the COVID committee just to let us know. We continue to work at making sure that we can keep the services going and keep everybody safe. So we thank you for that. Before I forget, so for those that have been at the last three services, what I do ask you at the end of the service is if you can remain seated. What will happen is we will bring round some wipes for everybody, and we ask that you just wipe the area that you've been sitting in, make sure that you clean, and then in a slowly and orderly fashion, once you've cleaned, we ask that you move out either outside or into the hall for a cup of tea. But we do ask that you stay seated until you have cleaned the area after you have finished. Thank you. Anything else? As you would notice, we don't have collection. And again, I thank you for all of those who have, again, continued to participate by doing the online collections. We're unable to do that now, but we thank you that you continue to help and support the church through this process. Let's come together for a prayer of thanksgiving and intercession. I would like to commence this prayer this morning with Psalm 34, verses 1 to 8. I will extol the Lord at all times. His praise will always be on my lips. My soul will boast in the Lord. Let the afflicted hear and rejoice. Glorify the Lord with me. Let us exalt his name together. I sought the Lord, and he answered me. He delivered me from all my fears. Those who look to him are radiant. Their faces are never covered with shame. This poor man called, and the Lord heard him. He saved him out of all his troubles. The angel of the Lord encamps around those who fear him, and he delivers them. Taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the man who takes refuge in him. Glorious Lord Almighty, we come this morning to take refuge in you. We know that you have loved those that have come to your care. Blessed is the man who comes to you for refuge. Your might and strength are beyond our understanding. Your love is patient. You gave us your Son, Jesus, who intercedes for us and has given us a life everlasting. We thank you for the gift of life, the ability to live, to love, to care, to share, and to know what pain and hurt feels like. We thank you that we never stand alone. We thank you for your continued presence in our lives. We thank you for the guidance and direction you provide, be it through your word, be it through the thoughts you give us, or be it through a friend that helps us see your way. Thank you, Lord, that we are here today as the first service where we, as an open church, once again seek to praise you and worship you. Thank you for keeping us all safe from illness and from this deadly virus that has taken so many lives today. We thank you for our country's leaders at a federal, state, and local level. We pray that you continue to help them know what is right and what needs to be done to look after your people. We pray for the leaders around the world, particularly where this virus is again rampant. We pray for our families and friends in these and other parts of the world, and ask for your hand over them at this challenging time. Lord, we thank you for Moses, Hannah, and Uri, and thank you for keeping them safe and secure. It's wonderful to hear your word preached through your servant Moses. And we ask that you continue to encourage him and enlighten him with your direction for your church. Lord, thank you for the crew that works every week behind the scenes, ensuring we have technology to see, listen, read, and participate in the messages provided. You know who they are, and we ask that you bless them and their families. Lord, we pray for our prayer groups, Bible study groups, the ladies' PWA, and sisters' group. May you watch over them and bless their time together, learning about you and building each other up in Christ. Lord, we pray for our families. Many of us are distant from them and often seek to want to close that gap. We ask that you help us to stay connected to family and help us to work on our relationship with those that we might be estranged from. Lord, help us to work on our relationship with you. Help us to make the time, dedicate our lives to being close to you. We often see the world first and the demands it makes on us. Forgive us for our failings and weakness. May we be encouraged, may we be courageous, may we be persistent and persevere to build on our relationship with you, no matter what might stand in the way. Father, you know our every need, and as we pray to you, you know of that which we haven't even asked. While we sit here quietly now, help us to share with you what is heavy on our heart. Father, we pray for those that have lost loved ones. Comfort them when it is hard to be at peace with the loss. For those that are unwell, may you provide healing and comfort. For those that are lonely, may they know your presence and know others that bring your light to the world. For those that are weak and frail, may you grant them mental strength to work with what they have. For those that may have lost their job or are struggling to make ends meet, Lord, we know you provide for the birds and all the animals. Please provide for them now. God, thank you for being here, hearing us as we fill this church. We cannot as yet lift our voices in song, but our hearts are lifted being here today with you and our fellow brothers and sisters. May you continue to help us, our community, and our country. Help us to know that we are blessed when we take our refuge in you. We ask this all in Jesus' name. Amen. The second Bible reading is from Romans 1, verses 14 to 17. I am a debtor, both to Greeks and non-Greeks, both to the wise and the foolish. This is why I am so eager to preach the gospel also to you who are in Rome. For I am not ashamed of the gospel, because it is the power of God that brings salvation to everyone who believes, first to the Jew, then to the Gentile. For in the gospel, the righteousness of God is revealed, a righteousness that is by faith from first to last. Just as it is written, the righteous will live by faith. May the Lord add his blessing to the reading of his holy word.
As I already said at the beginning of the service, October 31st is a Reformation Day. With these six words, October 31st is a Reformation Day, I believe I may already have lost many of your listening ears. So boring. But this is such an important day in the Christian calendar, as it remembers and celebrates the Reformation that was ignited by Martin Luther in 1517. Why do we need to talk about something that happened 500 years ago? It's because the message of Reformation is not a message that began with Martin Luther, but with Jesus Christ, the first true reformer. And it is something that is to continue today in the church and in our daily lives. So rather than go back to the future with Michael J. Fox, I invite you to go forward to the past with Jesus Christ. Let's go back to 2,000 years ago. Let's begin our journey with Jesus as he was teaching in the temple court in Jerusalem. John's Gospel, chapter 8. Pharisees brought a woman who was caught in adultery. They did it in order to trap Jesus. They told him that the law of Moses said that she was to be stoned. If Jesus agreed, he would have gone against Roman rules, that they could carry out their sentence without permission from Rome. If he disagreed, Jesus would be against the law of God. So, that was a trick. Jesus did not argue whether she was guilty or not. Rather, he challenged the one without sin to throw the first stone at her. In other words, we are all guilty of sin And we all need forgiveness. We all need to be freed from slavery to sin. In the following verses, Jesus went on to tell who he was. Then in our passage, this morning's passage, John's Gospel chapter 8, verses 31 to 38, Jesus speaks to those who profess to believe that Jesus is God. And he challenges them as to whether they are truly his disciples. He says to them, and he says to the Roman Catholic Church before the Reformation, and he says to the Protestant Church today, and he says to each one of us, if you hold to my teaching, you are really my disciples. Then you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free. Jesus is saying, not just believe his word, but you hold on to it. You must abide or dwell in it. The Pharisees didn't agree because they were descendants of Abraham and they were the chosen race of God. Jesus told them they were not really Abraham's children. They were physically and biologically, but spiritually they were not. You have heard that God has no grandchildren. I told you a couple of times before. God has no grandchildren. You are either a child of God or not. You can't say you are because your parents are or your grandparents are. You need to hold on to a word for yourself. God doesn't have a grandchild. God doesn't have a great-grandchild. They were not real children of the faith of Abraham. They were not children of God. Jesus knew they were slaves to sin, trying to follow rules. And human tradition does not free us from slavery to sin. To hold on to Christ's word and to trust in him only, that sets us free. We are then not slaves, but free children of God, free forever. But we have a permanent place in the family that no one can take away. But not the Pharisees, and not those who follow the tradition of the church. Jesus came to reform the church, to remove its faults and abuses. Through the teachings of the Jewish church, no one was set free. For it did not teach salvation through faith and by grace, but through works. It judged who was a sinner or was not on its own rules. If we move ahead 1500 years, we see the situation was not very different. 500 years ago, Martin Luther was struggling with the church. As the Jews had come from Abraham, who had true faith, the church descended from the apostles of Christ, who taught salvation through Christ alone, grace alone. But both generations had forgotten the simple truth and added their own rules and their own traditions. Martin Luther saw something wrong in the church. The concept of God as a judge who demanded righteousness and was so far removed from man that he could only be approached through the Virgin Mary or other saints, that you had to obey church authorities, you had to obey the Pope, cardinals, priests, and the fathers and bishops to go to heaven. The more Luther tried to please God, the more he realized he could not do it. So he turned to the Word of God in despair. He then found this passage, Romans chapter 1, verse 17. The righteous will live by faith. And Romans chapter 3, verse 28. A person is justified by faith apart from the works of the law. Finally, Martin Luther was freed as Jesus had promised 1500 years before. He was freed from trying to do that which is impossible. He was freed from sense of guilt. He was freed from failure. He was freed from the terror of sin. He was freed from being a slave to sin. He was freed to be a son of God. With this new discovery, he tried to show the church its wrongs, but it would not listen to him. They excommunicated Martin Luther, and the Protestant church was begun. Luther and other reformers like John Calvin, Zwingli, and John Knox called the church to get back to the basics, the Word of God, sola scriptura. The Bible alone is the rule of faith. We are saved by grace only, through faith only, by Christ only. In Christ alone, we have salvation. Happy Reformation Day. But the problem is not over. Even though we are the children of God, we are still sinners and we are subject to error. Whether it be because of pride or our own sin, or our desire to explain God's word better than he did, the church keeps on shifting away from the simple truth. I believe the Roman Catholic Church today is much better, that there are born-again Christians in it. But it still holds that that man-made sacraments necessary for salvation, an error that can prevent people from trusting in Christ alone. The Pope openly proclaims that Jesus is not the only way to God. But there are still errors in the Catholic Church. But it's certainly better. Many Protestant churches worldwide are seriously corrupted too. If I take one example, the churches in South Korea, you will be shocked. There are many, many churches in South Korea that are billionaires. They build luxurious, mega-sized church buildings in the cities. They treat their ministers as if they are mediators between God and men. And very often in bigger churches, when ministers retire, their sons succeed the senior minister position. The guy on the right hand side, who claimed to be a prophet of God, publicly said, "Hey God, don't mess with me, I can kill you." He might have said it in, jokingly, he might have said in some sort of different context, but he already crossed the line. But he is followed and supported by thousands of churches. Churches in South Korea need a reformation right now. Most of the churches would agree we need changes. There are wrongs and problems. In looking up that phrase on internet, I came up first with a group by such a name. I read a speech to the group by men saying, changes must include openness to ordaining homosexuals, so making gay people ministers, or legalizing abortion for the sake of women's rights, or euthanasia for human dignity. These people might think They are reforming in the spirit of Reformation, but they are not. Christian is not about needing change, but how we move ahead to make changes. And Jesus, our Lord and Savior, provides the answer. The truth of God will set you free. Over and again, we need to go back to God's Word to see and check where we should be heading. We always need to be brought back to God's ways and God's will. Brothers and sisters, problem with the church is not just with the church, but with each one of us too. When we first believe, we often dwell in the Word of God. We loved the Bible, we read it, we tried to memorize verses, then we know it, so we don't spend as much time in it. Problem is we apply what we know without going back to see and check what we don't know or what we have forgotten. Soon we no longer feel set free by Christ. We are slaves to sinful ways of the world, or slaves to legalism and falling short. We need to move forward in faith, as church and as individuals, to be reformed and renewed all the time, every moment. Brothers and sisters, we need to let the truth of God set us free. Let's pray. Almighty God, gracious Lord, we thank you for preserving your holy church throughout the ages. For the gift of the gospel, we praise your name. For the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection from the dead, and the life eternal in Christ, we thank you, loving Father. We treasure the rich heritage handed down from our fathers in the faith. Hear our prayer, which we ask in the name of your Son, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, three persons but one God, through all eternity. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all, now and forever.